All right, joining us now on Hot Copy, we have with us House Deputy Majority Leader and Iloilo First District Representative Janet Garin. Representative Garin, good morning to you.
Good morning, Carmen, and thank you for inviting me.
All right. So as of today, one would have to say there are only four lawmakers who voted against RBH7, and it's called Econ Chacha. That's the bill for Econ Chacha. And it's already essentially passed on second reading. Where does this go from here? Let's start first with that. Of course, it goes on third reading, but give us a timeline that you're seeing.
Well, it depends on the priorities of the House, since we will be having our last session next week. And the chances are it will be passed on third reading unless there would be move to bring it back to the debate on the floor. Mm. However, as we have observed, there was already sufficient time and there were no more interpellators. We even stayed until wee hours, until late in the evening. And so I believe chances are it will be passed on third reading and transmitted to the Senate.
All right.
Or on the other hand, we might be waiting also for the Senate version. I believe the leaders of of both Congress and Senate will be discussing this in the coming days.
Okay. Now, Representative, I'm curious, is there a timeline when the president wants this passed? Because it looks like in the lower house, the likelihood of this passing by next week, it's pretty big. It's almost expected. But in the Senate, what kind of debates are you expecting?
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, I am not aware of a timeline that the president has set. No? Our leaders may probably be more knowledgeable about that. But when we talk about Congress passing it in a third reading, it's basically sending a message that when we talk about legislation, this should be time-bound. And consultation, discussion with our constituents can actually be done in many facets. It can be online. We don't really have to go around the country and do consultations one-on-one in certain areas and big cities. Because at the end of the day, when elections come, we all have to go back to step one. And that's actually a waste of taxpayers' money because we have been deliberating on many measures repeatedly. I'm not just referring to economic chacha. So it's basically the message there is we have to deliver to our people legislative measures that will make a difference in their lives. Now, if the Senate mm-hmm. is not amenable with RBH6, then we will accept that and explore other legal means by which we can amend the Constitution, specifically on the economic provisions.
All right. Now, the resolution of both houses inserts the phrase, unless provided for by law, in clauses on ownership. So let's talk about this verse. Unless provided for by law. What difference would this verse make, this phrase make in terms of turning the economy around? And let's be specific on how different it will be with that verse in the Constitution.
You will actually have flexibility. Bottom line, the intention of that provision is to give our country the flexibility to be answerable to the current times. Many of what is happening now globally is not attuned with the situation when the Constitution was crafted. And without this flexibility, let's talk about land ownership, let's talk about even the Public Service Act, you know, that has been questioned in the Supreme Court. And the problem in a country where investors will have a confusion or the fear of changing rules every now and then. If you change guards and if you change rules every now and then, investors will have a cold feet. They'd rather go to Vietnam, they'd rather go to Indonesia, they'd rather go to Thailand. And this phrase simply means a flexibility is given to both Congress and Senate so that if there are matters that should be immediately tackled to be competitive, to be globally attuned with what is happening, then Congress can craft laws, legislate things, and pass it without interest groups questioning it before the Supreme Court. Mm. And that will actually, let's say if we're talking about utilities and let's say we're talking about logistics and transport, if we allow foreign companies to come into the Philippines, then that will actually widen the competition and reduce the costs. But as of now, it's highly restrictive.
Okay. With the Public Service Act, let's talk about that a bit. Many have made a good point or argument with that. Essentially, that particular law redefines what utilities are to, am I correct? Is it services? My memory escapes me now.
Yes.
Right?
Yes,
and
yes.
Under utilities, it has to be completely Filipino-owned, which is telecoms, I think railways. And by moving that to services, it opens complete foreign ownership. That's correct?
Yes.
And you feel
so you also talk about connectivity.
Yeah. And you feel that's not enough because there are two petitions before the Supreme Court questioning the constitutionality of that law.
And precisely that's the point, that why we need economic cha-cha. Everybody accedes and everybody accepts that there's really a need to open our country to investors. But again, the Constitution is very restrictive. That's why the inclusion of the phrase there, unless otherwise provided by law, is actually an avenue to give us flexibility. Mm. But it does not mean that it will automatically allow foreigners to come in and meddle with all aspects of governance. Mm. We will now move to the next step, which is legislation.
So
and again,
there will be
active participation.
Yeah, so it seems it's really that particular law that's the game changer. And the other one would be the issue on land. When it comes to land, is it an issue of foreign ownership or longer leases? Because all over the world, there's been a move against foreign ownership of land.
It can actually be both. But the problem with the long-term leases, I mean, if you are an investor and you want to come into the Philippines, apologies for this, Karen,
but
you know, our country has actually been known to change guards every now and then. With a new administration, with a new government, contracts are rescinded, palaging nagbabago. So there's that fear among investors that without owning that property, somebody can just come out and look for faults and rescind that contract. So what will happen to their investment?
So
there's a huge uncertainty.
You are for foreign ownership of land, personally?
For certain utilities and for certain businesses, yes.
But not residential?
Not presidential.
Okay. All right. Okay. Because there's a move worldwide. I'm sure you've heard about it in Portugal, for example, right now, New Zealand, Canada. If you're a foreigner, you're no longer allowed to buy a residential land because it spiked the prices up and it's become very hard for the locals to buy their own homes. So that's an issue.
Well, that is true.
Yeah.
That is true. And what those countries are doing is actually correct when it comes to protecting their people because their nationals cannot compete with the economic or the financial capability of the foreigners buying land and buying property. So that is correct. However, when we talk about investors, let's say you would like to put up a research facility and the land is owned by the government or on the I'm not even sure if the government really
but
has huge
does it
lands.
Have Most... to be, I'm curious, does it have to be ownership or let's say a 99-year lease?
Well, that's what I was saying earlier. There's also a huge mistrust on the government changing its policies every now and then. And that is something that the Philippines is suffering. Yeah, let's talk about investors coming in. Let's say they'll put up a logistical hub. And then all of a sudden, government will say, oh, we have to reduce that lease. But the lease actually is with a private entity.
Yeah.
But mind you, Karen, when we were talking about NGCP and the problems on power, and this is specifically on Visayas and Iloilo, the problem of NGCP putting in substations is the fact that they have problems. It's not that they cannot buy land. They have problems of acquiring, of land acquisition, because the prices are so high. You're already a captive of the few people who owns hundreds or even thousands of hectares in the Philippines, and it's only a few.
Okay. All right. So I'm curious, advertising and education is still, is this still being argued as a major economic changer?
Well, education is one aspect where we are receiving a lot of opposition. Of course, from the specifically from the owners of educational institutions, but not the professors. The professors are actually very are very much wanting of Econ Chachap with regards to education.
Okay, and advertising. I don't see the difference, frankly. You have with ABS having no franchise, CNN shutting down. I mean, I don't think advertising is that lucrative for foreigners in the Philippines.
Well, personally, I don't really think so. But since it was included in the Senate version,
yeah. But where will they advertise?
Mining would actually, on a personal note, yeah. No, mining would have been better because we are tied with a few players in the mining industry. So much so that sometimes many rules and many laws are violated because the capability of some of the players is not that extensive. However, it was not included, okay. And of course.
But right now, as it is in mining, can't foreigners own a mining company in partnership with the government? That was an argument that Christian Monson made a few days ago.
Actually, mining, exploration of natural resources is not included in RBH 6 and RBH 7. So while we wanted it, we don't want it to be the reason that Senate will not pass their version simply because there is an additional aspect on Econ Chacha. They only wanted 3, and we that's a lot better than nothing.
Okay. Now, the Constitution is one thing, but isn't the problem that we face in the country, frankly, much more than that? Like, let's name the real issues. In Vietnam, for example, it's so easy to put up a business. I mean, clearly, the structure of government is so different that if a foreigner comes in, wants to put up a company, essentially, they wouldn't have issues of right-of-way, right? And I believe in some countries right now, electricity is even subsidized. So the issues we face in the Philippines, why we're not having enough foreign investors, the ease of doing business, corruption from government, humihingi ng lagay, right? The price of power is so expensive. So there's so many other issues. I mean, in Singapore, for example, you want to put up a power plant. A businessman has told me 3 days, you either have it or you don't. Dito, you need 165 signatures. So is it really the Constitution that's the issue, frankly? Or really, it's just bureaucracy?
The Constitution is one major issue. However, you are correct. Bureaucracy and corruption are also two factors that deters the influx of investors in our country. And mind you, Karen, it's not just the problem of at the national, at the central offices. It's a deeper problem down in the local government units, up to the barangay levels, where there is a misconception that a local chief executive or even a barangay captain or a barangay official can perceive himself as very powerful, so much so that they start obstructing businesses.
All right. Now, Congressman Ed Selagman, he voted against RBH7, and he said it is flawed both procedurally and substantially. And with this argument, is there a possibility that the manner in which the Constitution is being changed will be brought before the Supreme Court?
That's actually a possibility, but we stand firm. Well, Senate has started deliberating RBH6. We are almost done with RBH7. That alone shows that there was due process being conducted. And if there are no dissenting opinions, then we proceed with a BICOM. On the other hand, Congressman Lagman would like us to possibly do a CONAS or a constitutional commission. I'm not sure if he is amenable with people's initiative. But these are all, that is the beauty of a democratic country, discussing legislative actions, whether these are within the bounds of law, or these are not within the bounds of law.
Okay, so just to end, what is Congress envisioning? So once, let's say, RBH7 is passed, it moves to the Senate, right? When it moves to the Senate, let's make a hypothetical situation. They pass it. And then you convene as both houses and you vote separately. Is that what we're expecting?
Well, if Senate can, of course, come up with its approved version, chances are Congress will adopt it.
Okay.
Though we don't totally agree that that is all that is needed, at least that will be a good start. Mm-hmm. So when we adopt it, when we adopt their version, it's basically allowing a faster deliberation of a proposed measure.
Okay.
And then everything
then it
else
moves
follows.
Does it move to a constituent assembly separate voting? Has that been decided?
Well, the mere fact that they are doing RBH6, we're doing RBH7, that's already doing it separately.
But then in terms of the voting, the convening, you'd still have to convene.
Yes, yeah, so we will tackle that issue when we come to that point. Because as of this point of time, we are still confused whether Senate is really sincere in tackling RBH6. Because it does not seem to, well, before the Senate president assured the public that they will tackle it until March of 2024. Mm. But the way things are moving, we are seeing the possibility of, we are looking at possible delays from their end. And then when the elections will come, we don't know if they will have the time to deal with it. So as of this point of time, I believe that people should understand what is in it there for us so that Senate will move.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much, Congresswoman Janet Garin. Thank you for joining me today.
Thank you, Karen. God bless.